Welcome to another of my classes. This is a poem from your ICSE treasure trove. The name of the poem is Bangle Sellers by Sarojini Nair. Okay. Now, those of you who don't have the textbook again, go and get your textbooks. It's on page 13. Take it out, pause the video, take it out, and actually the poem starts from page 14, but go into 13 because there are some things which are important. Now, Sarojini Naidu is a very important character in terms of the freedom struggle of India. She wrote a lot of literature devoted to the Indian freedom struggle. Okay. And she is referred to, if you can see here, it's written, it's called The Nightingale of India by Mahatma Gandhi because of the color, imagery and lyrical quality of her poetry. So that's an important assessment by the father of the nation. Now, if you go down to the last para, there is Sarojini Naidu's important presence in the freedom struggle. Her birthday is celebrated as Women's Day to recognize the powerful voices of women in Indian history. So, again, you can realize how important a writer she was. She wrote various writings. Now, there are many poems of hers, like where she wrote in a veiled manner, highlighting the hardships which Indians were facing under the British rule and how to kind of rise up against the British. She didn't write anything directly as such, but indirectly she tried to make the people rise up against the British. Like there's a poem called The Harp of India, where India is compared to a harp, musical instrument, which was earlier, before the coming of the British, it was in a very working condition, it was very majestic, and it gave out a sweet music. And then in the later part of the poem, she explains how the poem, that the harp is now in tatters and it's a broken down condition, and in that manner. Then again, there is another poem where she compares India to a high flying eagle. Now, before the independence, the British rule, she was, she says, India was like a free-flowing bird, an eagle, which was high-flying. But then under the British rule, she says, it is chained and it is captive, its wings are clipped and such things. So it's kind of a restricted. So in this way, using imageries, she highlights the importance of the hardship that the Indians are facing, enticing them to revolt against the Britishers. So that's what the poem is about. But of course, many a times, this poem of course is not about that, it's about Bangle Sellers. But although it starts with the Bangle Sellers, it then gradually moves on to the Indian society, particularly the role of women in Indian society. Okay. General basis, the poem has been criticized for its content. It'll say that it highlights about patriarchal society. But if you look at it in this way, that in pre-independence time, women were not so free. It was indeed a patriarchal society, and it was indeed a time when men enjoyed the predominant position. Women were confined to the background. So there's nothing wrong in it, and women in those days used to selflessly devote their lives to the service of their family, and they did not expect anything in return. So they selflessly devoted their lives to their families, first towards their husband, then towards the children, then towards the whole family in general. So this was the way in which they devoted their lives. Okay. So now we move on to the poem, which is page 14. It was written in 1912, the second book, The Bird of Time, which is a collection of poems, the third section, Indian Folk Songs. It's from there that the poem has been taken. Okay, so now it's a kind of a lyrical poem with a very musical quality to it. There's verbal melody here, as you will see through the words that are used. Color imagery is there, images from nature, natural imagery that is. And structure wise, this poem, each stanza is a quatrain and has a couplet at the end. Now what is a couplet? Couplet are two lines which are repeated, or two lines which are rhyming with one another. Okay, so quatrain is four lines. If you see, each of the stanzas have six lines, and the first four lines are the quatrain and the next two lines are the couplet which rhyme with one another. Like you see, the first stanza, lives and wives, the last two words, lives and wives, they match up. Okay, so this poem is about, let's go into the poem. Bangle sellers are we who bear our shining loads to the temple fair. Now bangle sellers, bangles were an integral part, or even today they are an integral part of Indian movement. Okay, and we are bearing a load, we are carrying a load. Okay, shining loads to the temple fair. Now why shining loads? Because number one, the sunlight is falling on them, making them illuminated, making them more colorful than they actually are. There are a variety of colors, number one. Number two, the bangles itself, the bangle sellers are carrying a variety of colors of bangles for different age groups of women. Okay, temple fair. Now why temple fair? Temple fair because temple is the place where women of all groups come to offer their prayers. So when they go there, they have a major chance of having a lot of more customers compared to sitting down in the market where there would be men and women both. But if they go to the temple where there's a fair, it's a kind of, or in those days this was the only kind of recreation for women like this, for girls, for maidens, everyone, they used to go and flock towards those temple fairs, or any fair for that matter. Who will buy these delicate, bright, rainbow-tinted circles of light? Now, who will buy? The answer is, of course, the different varieties of bangles that are on offer will be bought by the different age groups of women. Who will buy these? The women will buy, of course. Rainbow-tinted circles of light. Now, this is an example of metaphor. Now, I've told many times, you pause the video, underline it, you have a pencil ready to jot down all these points. So, they are rainbow-tinted circles of light. This is a metaphor. Why metaphor? Now, the colors of the rainbow are compared to the colors of the bangles. Variety of colors in the bangles, which is equal to the variety of colors, which is 7 of the rainbow. Okay. So, rainbow tinted circles of light. Now, circles of light, if you see the rainbow, it's like a semicircle. And a bangle, of course, is an entire circle. So, that is another reason why the circles of light are used. Okay. So, rainbow tinted circles of light. Lustrous tokens of radiant lives. Lustrous tokens, of course, lustrous means shiny. Tokens, symbols of radiant lives. Radiant lives means bright lives. The woman are, of course, very happy. It's a sign of their happy lives. Okay, now this takes us to another aspect, that widows in those days were not allowed to wear bangles. So they cannot say that, yes, we are indeed wearing bangles. They cannot be said to be happy. So only married women, unmarried girls, teenage girls, brides, they wore bangles. Okay. Now moving on, for happy daughters and happy lives. Now happy daughters and happy wives, say happy daughter and happy wives. You can understand the word happy is used for daughters and wives who are happy. Daughters who are happy in their with their family members, their parents, their other family members, and wives who are happy in their household. So that's another interpretation. Moving on. Second stanza, it refers to maidenhood. Maidenhood means girls in their teenage, or a little bit before that, not even teenage, because girls were married off at a very early age, a little bit before that. Okay, so you can call it a maidenhood. Summer meet for a maiden series. Now meet doesn't mean like you meet someone, it's not like that meet. Meet means here it's fit, if I fit for a maiden's wrist. Silver and blue as the mountain's mist. Silver and blue as the mountain mist is an example of simile. Okay, you have the word here as. Just as the mountain mist it's a silver and bluish colored. Similarly, the color of the bangles is also like that, similar to that. So that's a visual image. You also, you just close your eyes and you imagine the mist on the mountains, and you can easily imagine the color of the bangles that the girls are wearing. Some are flushed like the buds that dream on the tranquil brow of a woodland stream. Flushed like the buds that dream. Now, this is again an example of personification, wherein what happens? The buds are said to flush. Flush is to be just a tinge of pink, just like you have in Hearts and Hands. Miss Fairchild's cheeks, there was a tinge of pink. So here also the same thing. The thing being referred to, the buds are as if flushing. Actually, the buds are in a light pinkish kind of a color. Okay, so that is flushed. Some are flushed like the buds that dream. So the buds are flushing like that. Some are flushed like the buds that dream on the tranquil brow of a woodland stream. Tranquil brow of a woodland stream. Why does she say this? Because the woodland stream is gentle and calm. It is calmly flowing. Okay. And on that, there is the bud, flower bud, which is growing probably side by, and it is in a very happy and calm, relaxed state. Now, this is compared to the calmness in the life of the girl, which is why calmness of the brow. Tranquil brow, that is said. There is no tension, there is no worry, there is no calamity in the lives of these girls. So, they are very calm and quiet and leading just a similar life like that of the particular flower bud, which is blossoming by the side of a woodland stream. Okay, so it's an example of metaphor. That is why metaphor, you know, it's an implied simile. Simile, the meaning is directly stated. Implied simile means the meaning is hidden. Some are aglow with the bloom that cleaves to the limpid glory of newborn leaves. Now, newborn leaves, you have seen it, the color is light greenish, okay, light greenish. So some are aglow. So the moment you look at the tree, an old tree, you realize these are new leaves, these are old leaves. Against the backdrop of the dark green leaves, which are old, you have the flushing leaves. So that is why the newborn leaves. Some are aglow with the bloom that cleaves. Cleaves means sticks to the limpid glory of the newborn leaves. Again, this is an example of visual image. You know, all these three lines are examples. You have visual imagery. Just close your eyes, you can imagine these things, the new leaves which have come in. Okay, so limpid glory of newborn leaves. Now moving on to the, this stanza ends about the maidens. Now moving on to a little bit further, a little bit older. Now the girl is a bit more old. She is now going to be married. It's a marriage day. Marriage of the girls. It's about the bride. Some are like fields of sunlit corn. The word like suggests that this is a simile. What is the comparison here? Sunlit corn. Fields full of sunlight. Sorry. Corn fields, which are ripe corn. You can see it's golden. And then there, on top of that, there is the sunlight, which makes it all the more golden. So similarly, some are like fields of sunlit corn, meet for a bride on a bridal morning. On a bridal morning, the girl is wearing yellowish, golden colored bangles. Maybe they are of gold, maybe they are of yellowish. So she's wearing those bangles, yellowish colored, bright, and it looks as if the color of those bright corn fields have come into her wrists through the bangles. Next, some are like the flame of a marriage fire, or rich with the hue of her heart's desire. Now, again, you see this line again and similarly, some like the flame of a marriage fire. The marriage fire is an essential component. Fire is an essential witness to any religious ceremony. It's said to be the witness, okay? Whether you have any sacrifice, any other puja being done, or any other worshipping activity done, or any other, just like marriage also. So the fire is the witness that this man and this woman is going to be married in the happy marriage wedlock. So similarly, here, some like the flame of a marriage fire. Now already there is golden. With that, you have a little bit of red, which gives us the color of the flame of the fire. Okay, red and golden, which gives you the color of the fire. So that is the comparison. Some like the flame of a marriage fire or rich with the hue of her heart's desire. Now, hue is the color. It seems to reflect this golden and yellow color, red color that's there on her wrists. It seemed to kind of reflect the heart's desire that she has. The flame is a reflection of her heart's desire. She's very excited. She's going to start a new life. She's going to be married. She's going to have a husband and a family of her own. So that excitement, the flame of excitement seems to be reflected in that. Okay. Tinkling, luminous, tender and clear, like her bridal laughter and bridal tear. So they are tinkling, luminous, the tinkling sound of the bangles, they remind us of the sound of her laughter. Now there are two parts, bridal laughter and bridal tear. The tinkling refers to her laughter. Okay. And the bridal tear, of course, she is sad. On a marriage day, she is happy, her marriage is taking place. And she's sad also. Why? Because of her. The reason is she is going to go away from her father's house. She's going to go to an entirely new household. Okay. So tinkling, luminous, tender and clear, like her bridal laughter and bridal tear. So this is also an example of paradox. Okay. First of all, I'll tell you, bridal laughter and bridal tear. These you underline and write paradox. Why paradox? They are opposite. See, bridal laughter and then there is bridal tear. Now, bridal laughter, bridal tear, they are opposite. Laughter and tear. So that is why paradox. That's the opposite. Next, coming to like her bridal. Now, like is again, you know, it's a simile. The tinkling of the bangles here is compared to her laughter when she's very happy, joyous. She is with her friends, relatives. She's very happy mood. So that seems to be reflected through the tinkling of the bangles, the one bangle tinkling against the other. Okay, so tinkling of the bangles. Luminous, tender and clear. Luminosity is the giving out of light. Okay, so she is full of happiness, of course, and at the same time there are tears in her eyes. Now when there are tears, the tears shine. Just as that, the light falls on the bangles and they also shine. So they are luminous, tender and clear. You can understand the glass bangles, so they are tender, easily broken, fragile and clear, very clear. Moving on to the last part, which is last stanza, wherein she is now the matriarch. A number of years have passed by. Okay, number of years have passed by and she is now the matriarch of the house. Matriarch of the house means she is the mother of children. She is now the, you can say, the head of the family, the main mistress, the ruling power in the household after her husband. Okay, maybe now her mother-in-law is dead or she is a bit invalid, so she has now the control, like they say, the ghar ki chabi usi ke paas hai. So that kind of thing. Okay. Some are purple. Now in this part it says some are purple and cold flecked gray. So now the color changes. She doesn't have those bright colors like that of a bride. She doesn't have those innocent colors like that of a maiden. She now has mature colors. Purple and gold flecked gray. So that's the color which she has. Gold, purple and gold flecked gray. Gold flecked means there are dots of gold in between those gray bangles. Purple, gray, and in between there are dots of gold here and there. For she who has journeyed through life midway, she has reached the midway of life. She is now in the throngs of middle age. That's the point of her age now. From the bride, she comes to this position. She has come to this position now. Whose hands have cherished, whose love has blessed. Hands have cherished with her hands. She has cherished with her hands. She has looked after the whole family, her children, other family members, father-in-law, mother-in-law, other family members. Whose love has blessed, with her love she has blessed her children, of course, and cradled fair sons on her faithful breast. Now, many people say that this fair sons is a reflection of the society in those times, or even today also in the rural India, if you have a girl, you are looked down upon a little bit, and if you have given birth, if a woman has given birth to a son, then of course she is looked highly upon that she has given an heir to the family. So the family is looks up to her with pride that yes, she has delivered son. So here Sarojini Naidu highlights that particular part. She has given birth to sons. Fair sons on a faithful breast. So with her, on her faithful breast, she has cradled them, she has looked after them, she has fed them and everything. So faithful breast is an example of transferred epithet or hyphalage. H-Y-P-A-L-L-A-G-E, if you do not know the meaning. It's applying a certain quality onto a particular aspect of the body. Now see a faithful breast. Now it's about the faithful, the word is entirely on the person. But here that particular word is referred to or associated to one body part. So here the mother's dependability and faithfulness is, which is for her entire being, is associated with one body part. Only her breast is referred to. And serves the household in fruitful pride. With pride she serves the household. Yes, this is my household. I am the mistress here. I am the person in power. With fruitful pride, which she tries her best to educate her sons, children, guide out the family, and worship the gods at her husband's side. Now, worship the god at her husband's side. She has now acquired the position of sitting beside her husband. Okay. Now, see, the thing referred to here is in various religious ceremonies, the husband and the wife sit side by side. Now, this sitting side by side has a different annotation that the husband and the wife are beside one another in the thick and thin of things. Okay, so whatever the situation, hard times, good times, the wife is there beside her husband. So she has performed all her duties quite fruitfully. Okay, and she has been able to, in a way, give back to her family all that she could. And that is why in this way she leads a selfless life. Now after that it is not given anything, because maybe after this comes the time of old age where maybe she dies or her husband dies and she becomes a widow, and there is no role of the bangles itself. So that's the reason why this particular poem ends here itself. So through the use of the bangles, the different colors of the bangles that are used here by Sarojini Naidu, the different stages of the woman's lives are highlighted. The colors change, her age changes from the maidenhood, she moves on to the bride, and then she on the matriarchal stage where she's in the middle age. In this way, sequentially, it's like a whole journey of her life that is being highlighted out here in this way. Okay, thanks for watching. Do like, share and subscribe to my channel.